Good morning, my dear viewers and the believers in Jesus Christ. I would like to thank the Lord for giving this privilege to me so that I can share some message with you from the book of Luke, chapter 15, verses 8 to 10. And I would like to wish you a happy Sabbath. Before I go into my topic, I would like to have a short prayer. Let's pray. Our Father in Heaven, once again, we want to thank you for giving us this privilege of prayer and worship and praising your name at this time and witnessing for thee. What I speak may be your words, God. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. I know I am a sinner. I come to thee to take this message to the people who are groping in darkness. Bless all my listeners and me, for I ask this, your blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's go into our topic today, the value of just one. So when we look at the Bible in the book of Gospels, Luke chapter 15, and we read through this verses 8 to 10. If you have your Bibles, just read with me. It says, "Or what woman having 10 silver coins," how many coins? 10 silver coins. "If she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it." It says here, if she loses one coin, we see here, she will light a lamp, sweep the house, and seek diligently until she finds it. Okay, lighting a lamp because the room is dark, and then sweeping the house because she cannot find it without sweeping it. It's hidden somewhere under the bed or behind her boxes or under the carpet or whatever she has put on the floor, and then she has to seek till she finds it. That means the woman is determined to find the coin. The woman is determined to go into action. And the ninth verse says, "And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Okay, we see her losing the coin, lighting a lamp, sweeping the house, and then seeking it till she finds it, and finally rejoicing it. Just so I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents. That's how we are going to study this morning about this woman and the coin she has lost. Very beautiful passage from the Bible, and we need to ponder upon it because we are also lost sinners. When we look at here, the woman has a purpose in life. As I said, what is the purpose? She's lost a coin. Let's see some background about the coin that she has lost. So when we look at the coin, you know, it's small. When we look at the coin, it is hidden. When we look at the coin, it's dark in the room. But then the coin has an importance in the life of this woman. What is the importance of coin to her? In the time of Jesus Christ, or biblical time you can call it, the woman used to wear headband, the married woman I'm talking about, and they were given this headband, and in that headband there used to be coins. Okay, I said, how many coins? 10 coins she had. And those 10 coins they would put around their headband. If they were very rich, they would have more than 10. If they were not rich like this woman, they would have 10 that they would think is sufficient for them. And so this was a marriage sign for the young girl, putting a coin in the headband and then staying after the marriage with her husband. So you can imagine, these days we have a ring or we have a chain as a sign of marriage. But in those days the sign of marriage was the headband and the coins, number of coins the woman would be wearing on her head. It also declared her independence. How? Suppose the woman is married for some years, and maybe after 2 years or 3 years, the husband feels she is unfaithful. So when he feels she is unfaithful, he will leave her or divorce her. And this is how this woman would be considered as unfaithful to her husband, and therefore she is not allowed to wear the headband with the coins. And if she is not wearing the headband on her head, that is the society is going to look down upon her, and this would create lot of problems for the woman if she does not have a headband. So you can see the importance of the coin this woman has. This also shows she has 10 coins. When you look at the verse, an 8th verse, where it says she has, having 10 silver coins, she loses one. In the parable of lost sheep, where there was 100 sheep and the shepherd loses one, and he goes out to find the one sheep that he has lost. In the same way, she has the 10 coins, but she loses one coin, and if anybody sees her with 9 coins, she would be disgraced in the society, and therefore she had to find the coin. Let's see, the purpose was to find the coin. The object is that to teach the sinner that every sinner who comes to Christ is valuable for God. If you look at Isaiah 43 verse 7. Come with me to Isaiah 43 verse 7. If you have your Bibles with you. And it says here in verse 43 verse 7. Okay. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. Who is everyone? When we look at who, you and me are in the category of everyone. Who are called by which name? My name. If I put my name there, I am called, Rebecca is called by name. And Rebecca is created for God's glory, and Rebecca has been formed and made. Okay, so let's remember, if we put in place of everyone, if I put my name in place of my name, if I put my name, the verse becomes more meaningful to me, because I am the one who's created by God, I am the one who's formed by God, I am the one God has formed me to give glory to His name. So this is very clearly says every sinner is created for God's glory. When we look at Genesis 1:26, it says, let us make man in our own image. Who is the man? You and I. Okay, man refers to both woman and children, woman and man. Okay, so here God says, He has not taken any other form. By creating the man in some other form, He has taken the form of His own likeness, God's own likeness, God's own image. He has created us because He loved us. If He did not love us, He would have given us some other shape, which would have been very ugly. But He has given us beautiful face, beautiful eyes, nose, hands, feet, mouth. You know, every part of our body is very valuable to God, because it is created in the image of God. If you look at verse Genesis 3:8, we see this creation chapter, the beginning few chapters we see, God used to come and meet them daily because they were righteous. when Adam and Eve were created, they were righteous. They were not sinners. But when they did the sin of disobedience, they became unrighteous. And God, who was visiting them daily, He stopped visiting them because there was a curtain of sin between Adam and Eve and God. God could see them, but Adam and Eve could see God no more. In the same way, the sin is separating us from God. Because God can see us, we cannot see God. We can see His works in our life. We can see the miracles happening in our life, but we cannot see God in through face to face. So when we look at God stopped walking with them once they had committed the sin of disobedience. When we look at Genesis chapter 3, verse 23. Now this couple, the first parents, Adam and Eve, God had to banish them from the Garden of Eden, and because of sin. But then He had a plan of redemption for them already. And that plan of redemption, they had their way to go to God. They were not lost in sin, but God was trying to restore them by sending His Son on this earth so that He would die for the sinners. When we look at Isaiah chapter 59 verse 2, it says, "Your iniquities have separated you from God." Now what are the iniquities that have separated us? Our sinful nature, our telling lies to the people, our injustice that we do with the others, we try to shout at people, show our temper. We do all kinds of things which are not right in the sight of God, and those become the iniquities of a sinner. And those iniquities are separating us from God. It is because we are living in sin. It is because we are committing the sin daily, every moment of our life, and we are not coming to the fold of God. If we come to the fold of God, His grace is sufficient for us. So therefore, we have to see how we can come to God. The iniquities can be reduced by our own action, by coming to God. He is ready to accept us as a sinner. Now when we look at the woman, she feels that one coin that is lost, that is very useful for us. If she does not have the coin, she is feeling what to do. She has to find it. And she makes a plan, as we read in this chapter. She says, she lights a lamp, sweeps the house, and then diligently seek it. Lighting a lamp, a sinner has to read his Bible, the Word of God, which is a light for each one of us, showing us the way to God's way, God's heavenly crown. And that is the Word of God, which tells us where we are in our life. It tells us where we are wrong, and it shows us the way how we can repent for our sins and come to the fold of God. So therefore we see the room is very dark. The woman is taking a lamp because she has to go into the every corner of the house. She has to go and see behind the boxes. She has to see under the carpet and sweep, and she has to see under the bed or whatever is there in her house. She has to see in that room full of darkness. And then the next thing she does is she goes into action. What is action? Taking a broom and sweeping. You know, when we sweep the house, we take away all the dirt of that room, of the house. We clean it. So therefore, she has taken the broom to clean the house. She has taken the lamp to see where the coin could be found. And then she keeps on sweeping the floor till she finds the coin. And ultimately, it is her diligent work which has helped her to find the coin, and she is very happy. And when we look at her in the same way, our lives are also like the coin. We are lost in the spiritual world. Okay? spiritual darkness, we are lost. We are away from God and still go into spiritual darkness. Satan has blinded the minds of the people. If you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 14, Satan is trying every means to take us away from God. Satan is trying every way where he does not want us to read the Bible, the Word of God. Satan does not want us to pray with the people, pray for the people, pray with the people. He wants us to get away from the people. He wants to show us the attractions of the world where our eyes become spiritually blind. And therefore, Satan is not losing his ground by blinding our faith, by blinding our mind. But Christ is always there, who is trying to show us the right path so that we go to Him. So when we look at the man is lost in the spiritual darkness, we also see the coin is lost in the dirt. When we look at the coin, it has a kind of a mark, okay, the stamp of the ruler, okay, the picture of the ruler on one side, and the other side may be the value of the coin. And so when we look at the coin, it's full of dust. She has swept it and thus finds there's lot of dust on the coin. So when we look at the image of the ruler is hidden, she needs to clean it. In the same way, we are also like sinners. Our image also is hidden. And we want to come back to the fold of God by the grace of God, which is sufficient for each one of the sinner who is willing to go to God. The lost coin is unusable because it is lost. The lost sinner feels that he needs to be cleansed. He feels hesitant to go to God and repent. He feels he is lost totally. He has come to the stage where he cannot go to God. That's not true. Every stage of our life we can go to God and repent for our sins. And therefore we want to say, He is going to restore us back to His glory, because He has made us into His glory. He has made us so that we can glorify His name, we could praise Him. That is why He has made us. We see the sinners are lost everywhere in the dwelling of the Lord. We see these sinners. Let's say we are lost, but God is willing to pick you up from there and take you to His home. And therefore, that is the place we have to go. When the coin is lost, the woman makes up her mind. Okay, how is she making her mind when she has lost the coin? Now she has decided, making her mind is, she has decided that she is going to find it by all means. Okay, and she has decided. Anything we do in the heart, in our life, we have to decide. We have to make up our mind, this is what I'm going to do. If I'm going to a market, I will decide, this is what I'm going to purchase, this is what I need. So I make up my mind. So here, she has decided to make up her mind, do what? To find the coin. That's her priority in life. Okay. The next she does is, when she has decided to find the coin, she is sweeping the house and she does not stop till she finds the coin. See, Father, once you make up your mind, you can easily do the things. But if you do not make up your mind, you will not be able to do anything. So therefore, you have to make up your mind, put into action that plan that you have decided, and then go according to what you have decided to do. So when we look at the woman is a picture of God. In what sense she is a picture of God? Because she is the one who is looking for the lost coin. God is the one who is looking for the lost sinner. God is the one who wants the lost sinner to come to His fold. When we read in Romans 5:18, while we were yet sinners, now who are we? You and me. While we were yet sinners, if I put, while Rebecca was yet sinners, he died. He here refers to Jesus Christ. Jesus died for me because he loved me. It becomes more meaningful if you put your name in that text and then you read the Bible and you are very close to God. So while we were yet sinners, he died for us because he loved us. Yes, he died for you and he died for me because he loved you and he loves us. He loved us yesterday, he is loving us today, and he will continue to love us tomorrow also. So therefore remember that Jesus is loving us all the time. Why don't we go to him? And 1 Peter 1:19 says, God gave his son to shed his love blood for us, a precious blood. The blood has life in it, and that was shed for you and me. John 3:16 says, God is the one who gave his son to die for you and me. Who is the Son of God? Jesus Christ. Who came to this earth like a baby? Jesus Christ. And Satan tried to harm him by through King Herod, who made out a decree that all the male child below 2 years should be slain. So when we look at, Satan was trying to harm the Son of God at his birth. Satan was trying to harm God after Jesus fasted for 40 days by having a temptation come to him. Satan again was trying his level best so that he would be able to defeat Jesus Christ, and he was unsuccessful. In all his attempts, Satan is the failure. So why should we listen to a failure person? We should listen to the person who died for you and me on the cross and shed his precious blood for you and me. We need to come to him. We need to understand how much God loves you and me. When we look at Matthew 11:28, it says, come unto me. Now, Christ is calling all of us, not one. All ye that labor, okay, all those who are sick, all those who are depressed, all those who feel injustice has been done to them, God is saying, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, take your burden and give it to God. Don't keep that burden to yourself, and then come to the fold of God and he will give you rest. God is calling the sinners to him. It says John 10 verses 28, it says, I give unto them eternal life. They shall never perish. Yes, John 3:16 also says, you come to me and they shall never perish. If we come to God, we will never perish. Nobody can take eternal life from us. Satan is always going to be the loser. So let's not go to the ways of the Satan, the ways of the worldly ways. Let's come to the fold of God. I would just like to tell you an illustration here. A man had saved some coins from his father's property. He had saved some while working, and that became a bag of coins for him. It so happened that there was flood in this area and the waters began to come into his rooms. So he took the bag of coin and he goes on to the terrace or the roof of the house. And then he is looking up, hoping that someone might come and rescue him and his bag of coins. After some time, after he prays, he sees a helicopter coming over, hovering over that house, the terrace. And the pilot of the helicopter drops the rope and tells the man, hold on to the rope with both hands. So the man, he takes the rope, and with one hand he is holding the rope. With the other hand, he takes the bag of coins and he is holding the bag of coin. Now he is trying to hold these two, but he is not successful. He feels the bag of coin is too heavy for him. He needs to save his life. So he decides to drop the bag of coins, and after dropping the bag of coins, he feels light and he is rescued. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, our life is more precious in the sight of God. Our life is more precious because God is waiting for us. The coin was too precious for this woman. It was valuable. It was lost, but she tried to find it. And the third part of the story tells us that there was rejoicing. It says here, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Rejoice with me. She's calling all her friends. There's going to be great rejoicing over every sinner who's is saved in heaven. There's going to be great rejoicing after we reach heaven when Jesus takes us to heaven. Great rejoicing is going to be there. There's going great praise of God will be there. We will be glorifying God for saving us to that heavenly home. When a sinner is restored, there's rejoicing in heaven. Yes, angels rejoice. They play their harps. They sing songs of thankfulness, gratitude, glorifying God all the time. God is glorified in heaven through angels. God is glorified by the saints here on earth who are always doing God's work. The sinner made dirty and ugly by sin. Yes. Once we make a mistake, we feel we are so ugly. God is not going to accept us, but we are sinners. God loves the sinner. God does not love the sin, but he loves the sinner. Let's remember that. And he is willing to do anything to restore us back to his fold. And Satan is also willing to do everything to show us the blind faith, to take us to the spiritual blindness of the world, to divert our mind from God's ways to satanic ways. Satan is trying his best, and God is waiting for us to go to his fold. Jesus is still seeking the lost sinners. He wants all of us to go to him, praise him, glorify his name, and rejoice in his name. Like the woman, she rejoiced with her friends. There is rejoicing in heaven for every sinner who is repenting and coming to the fold of Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father in heaven, once again, we want to thank you for the wonderful message that you have helped me to speak. We know people are groping in darkness. They are living in sinful life. They want to come to your fold. They are so depressed, God. We want to pray for them so that you will be very close to them, bringing them closer to your heavenly home. We want to pray for them who are groping in darkness, who have gone away from you, God. We want them to come back to your fold. We want to pray for all the sick ones, especially the people who are suffering with different kind of sicknesses. Especially these days, people are having their fear of corona. COVID-19 is the fear that people are thinking that they will surely die if they suffer from corona. But you, God, is the greatest healer of this world. You can do any miracles in the life of these people who are still depressed. We want you to bring them out of this depression, bring them out of this sinful state, bring them to thy fold, help them to rejoice in thy grace, help them to rejoice with thee. There is great rejoicing over every sinner who repents, God. And we want to pray for all those people who are groping in darkness. We want to pray for the poor and needy. We want to pray for all the people who are doing online services today and the other days, preaching thy word of God to the people so that your message goes into every weak nook and corner of the world and your coming may be hastened. Accept us as we are. Amen.